And I've preached, and the topic is going to be on marriage and divorce, and I'm going to go through basically all the different stages. So I thought it would be interesting to tackle it from this point of view. And that's why it might not be so much of an inspiring sermon. It'll be more of a doctrinal sermon, and one where you might learn something and go, oh, wait, I didn't know about that. That was interesting. So I'm going to go through the different stages. You go through, you know, unmarried, and there's a bit about the vows, and then what betrothal is, and then taking a wife versus marrying a wife, and then separation and divorce, and all those topics that we're going to be talking about. So I have preached on marriage before. Not all of you were here. So there's a few reasons why I just decided to touch on this topic again. One is because there are people getting married, there are people thinking about getting married, there are people looking for a wife. So that's one reason why I always love preaching about marriage and dating, because it's so relevant. Do you know what I mean? It's always relevant, it's always practical, but it's also so misunderstood. Do you know what I mean? Like, there's so many false ideas out there about dating and about marriage, and and that's why it's always an all-round winner, isn't it? Because that's probably the reason why, you know, amongst youth, it's the biggest topic that they talk about. I know, Pastor Hernan always told me, like, if you deal with youth, you're always going to be talking about either music or relationships, because these are the two things that young people struggle with until they start working and have a family and the troubles that come with that. So it's a big part of life, which is why it's such an important topic. But, you know, even if you don't plan on being married, or, you know, maybe dating and marriage is something that you did in the past and you're not looking for a wife anymore, I think it's always important. I always say this every time I preach about marriage and dating. It's very important to learn about this, because even though it may not directly apply to you today, it's very important that you know the answers to these questions, because it's such a big part of everyone's life. If you think about it, there's birth. That's why there's the birth industry, right? About births and everything. Everyone's having babies, and, you know, midwives and nurses and hospitals and whatnot. And then there's deaths. There's the funeral industry, because that's like what happens to everyone. Everyone gets born, everyone dies. Not everyone gets married, but everyone's part of a family, and everyone's sometimes looking for a spouse. So it's a big part of our life. So as Christians, it's very important that if somebody comes to you with questions, you have the right answers to give them, because it's going to affect a lot of people. And, you know, hopefully as we learn the biblical doctrines about dating and marriage and things like that, we can change the misunderstandings. We can change the culture, starting in our church, starting with our children, because there is a lot of wrong ideas out there. And these things linger as they pass down from generation to generation, just as traditions. But if we can have the right mindset, we can reset those traditions. We can reset that culture with us in this church. So this first sermon, I will probably only be able to cover, you know, the unmarried, vows, betrothal, and taking a wife. That's what I plan to cover. And then the next sermon will be about the marriage, separation, and divorce, that side of the topic. And the reason why, there's a couple of reasons why I decided to touch on this. Number one, because, there was a couple of people wanting to get married in church, and we were talking about the vows thing. So I thought I would touch on that. And recently I had a conversation with somebody about divorce and about the grounds for divorce. So there was a few new extra things that I hadn't preached in my previous sermons about marriage and divorce that I wanted to touch on, that I thought would be interesting for you guys. So let's cover the first topic. So the first topic is just about being unmarried. You know, what we would say single, being an unmarried virgin. So in 1 Corinthians 7, and I'm going to try and move through this really quick just because I have probably a lot to go through. In verse 34, 1 Corinthians 7, the Bible says here, there is difference also between a wife and a virgin. And we see here that it's used interchangeably with virgin. The unmarried woman careth for the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and in spirit, but she that is married careth for the things of the world, how she may please her husband. So we see here that a virgin is an unmarried person, but and the assumption there is that they haven't slept with anybody, right? That a virgin is somebody that is pure. You know, that's why they're unmarried, because they haven't slept with somebody. If you're unmarried and you have slept with somebody, the word for that is a whore. You know, you're a whore because you've committed fornication. So that's something you don't want to be. You know, you want to be a virgin, somebody who's pure, somebody who has kept themselves from fornication. as opposed to a whore that commits fornication. And then you have a harlot who commits fornication for money, right? Which we would call a prostitute. So now fornication, and I'll touch on this a bit later in next week's sermon, but fornication is basically any sexual act outside of marriage. So whether that's heterosexual acts outside of marriage, so, you know, if you have heterosexual sex with somebody you're not married to, it's fornication. If they are married, then that's adultery, right? Or homosexual acts, same-sex acts, is also considered fornication, right? Because it's a sexual act, but it's between two people of the same sex. So whether it's men with men or women with women. And then you have bestial, right? Which is when somebody has sex with an animal, which is totally disgusting, right? You know, just as disgusting as homosexuality is. But that's with an animal. That's also considered fornication, right? When somebody has sex with an animal or a lady allows an animal to have sex with them. You know, that's also fornication. And these things are so serious that God actually legislates these. So let's go to Leviticus 20, because he actually puts the death sentence on all of them except one. But I'll explain that in a second. So let's go to Leviticus 20:10, where we see these laws. And the man that committeth adultery with another man's wife, even he that committeth adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death. So see, this sin of fornication is so bad in the eyes of God because it affects, because remember we talked about family and relationships being such a big part of our lives that if fornication is allowed in a society, it destroys a society because it destroys families, it destroys marriages, it destroys godliness because it's such a big part of our lives and it's such a strong desire as well. If you think about our desires, we have a desire for food, we have a desire for sex, and these things are, you know, a large part of our lives. Says here, in verse 11, and the man that lieth with his father's wife hath covered his father's nakedness, both of them shall surely be put to death, their blood shall be upon them. And if a man lie with his daughter-in-law, both of them shall surely be put to death. They have brought confusion, their blood shall be upon them. So, you know, I believe in the capital punishment. I believe there are certain crimes that warrant capital punishment, and it's not just for them in those days. If God thought it best to have a law in those days to govern a people, that's the same laws we should be following today. So, you know, I believe that even today in our government, we should be enacting these laws. Now, the likelihood of us getting fornication laws as capital punishment, you know, I guess I don't have a lot of faith in the Australian system that we will ever, that will ever happen. Hey, there might be a day where murderers, I was talking about this with Kevin today. There might be a day when murderers and rapists and, you know, serial killers or whatever will be given the death sentence. I think there's still a lot of people that feel strongly about that because they get, you know, why should I pay for them to be in jail? But the argument of this is more one of prevention, right? Because the reason why God puts laws in place for fornication is because of the effect on society and putting the evil away from a society. Because when it's allowed, we have those examples. And we even see it in our own society when marriages are not upheld. We don't have the criminal punishments for fornication and adultery. And then it's just allowed and marriages get destroyed. Families get destroyed. Children are not raised as they should in a loving family. And of course, there's more to that than just having these laws in place. It's just, I guess it's just a bit of a harder sell because it's a moral stance as opposed to a stance of aggression, right? Where you actually hurt somebody else directly as opposed to indirectly your effect on society. Verse 13, if a man also lie with mankind, so this is homosexuality here, as he lieth with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination, they shall surely be put to death, their blood shall be upon them. And if a man take a wife and her mother, it is wickedness, they shall be burnt with fire, both he and they, that there be no wickedness among you. And if a man lie with a beast, so here's the bestiality, he shall surely be put to death, and ye shall slay the beast. So you don't even let the animal stay alive. That's how wrong this is, that you don't want the defiled animal to be alive. And if a woman approach unto any beast and lie down thereto, thou shalt kill the woman and the beast, they shall surely be put to death, their blood shall be upon them. So you see, there are laws in place. It's a very serious sin, fornication. This is one thing I was talking about with Christina and Elizabeth just before we came here. I just thought I'd share with you my thoughts. So we see here that in Leviticus 20, adultery had the death sentence, bestiality had the death sentence, homosexuality had the death sentence. But fornication doesn't have the death sentence. It's just fornication with an unmarried person is not the death sentence. But God still has very, very strict laws in place governing fornication. And I'll show you this in Deuteronomy 22, verse 28 to 29. 22, 28 to 29. Now it says here in Deuteronomy 22, verse 28, if a man find a damsel that is a virgin. So it's making a specific point here that this woman has not slept with somebody else, right? She's a virgin. Which is not betrothed, and lay hold on her and lie with her, and they be found. So they've slept together, and both of them have been found out. So this is not rape, like it says in some other Bibles, which is wrong. So you know how people get this idea in Bibles, like, oh, the Bible says that if somebody rapes you, then a woman's forced to marry the rapist. Where they're getting that from is from other Bible versions, which have been corrupted, like the NIV and those other Bibles. That says rape in Deuteronomy 22, 28, but the King James Bible doesn't say that because it's translated correctly. It says he just lays hold on her, right? And lie with her, and it says, and they be found. So it's very specific that it's not rape because they are both found out, right? Then the man that lay with her shall give unto the damsel's father 50 shekels of silver. So it's almost like a fine for the value of that woman's virginity. And she shall be his wife because he hath humbled her. He may not put her away all his days. So you see, if somebody fornicates with somebody, they're actually forced to be that person's husband. And that person is forced to be their wife. So you see how God governs fornication? Because now they're forced to be somebody's wife. If they go and fornicate again, now they committed adultery. So you can't just have this rampant fornication in God's system, because if you do, you're eventually going to come across the death sentence. Because if you're a virgin and you sleep with somebody, now you're that man's wife, you know, legally, right? And then if you, as a wife of somebody, go and fornicate with somebody else, now you've committed adultery, and an adulterer and an adulteress is put to death, according to Leviticus 20. Now, what I was talking about with Elizabeth and Christina this afternoon, just a thought here, and I'm not 100% on this, but just the thought of what is the difference between a concubine and a wife? Because I've always thought that a concubine was like, you know, like somebody's girlfriend that they're sleeping with, right? Like they're not married, they haven't made a vow, but they're sleeping with this person, and maybe they live together. And we would say, well, is that a concubine, where you're a live-in girlfriend, you sleep together, but you're not married. You're not a husband and wife. Now, I don't think that is the case, because in Judges 19, we read about the story of the man from Bethlehem, Judah. And if you remember that story in Judges 19, where it's the same, the Sodomites came, right, the reprobates came all around about. It's very similar to Genesis 19. And he gives over his concubine, and the concubine basically gets raped until the morning she dies. It's a terrible story. But look at here. We'll read in chapter 19. And it came to pass in those days, when there was no king in Israel, that there was a certain Levite sojourning on the side of Mount Ephraim, who took to him a concubine out of Bethlehem, Judah. He was a Levite, and his concubine was from Bethlehem, Judah. And his concubine played the whore against him and went away from him unto her father's house to Bethlehem, Judah. And there were 4 whole months. Now look at this. And her husband arose and went after her. Now, if a concubine is just like a live-in girlfriend, you wouldn't refer to the man as the husband, right? It's like the boyfriend or the partner that we would say. But this is making a point that no, like the concubine is considered, I believe, the wife of this guy, because he's the husband. Right? So it wouldn't make sense. Like you wouldn't say, I'm the husband, but then that's not the wife. You wouldn't say it though. So, but not only that, it says here, to speak friendly unto her and to bring her again, having his servant with him and a couple of asses, and she brought him into her father's house. And when the father of the damsel saw him, he rejoiced to meet him. And his father-in-law, the damsel's father, retained him, and he abode with him 3 days. So they did eat and drink and lodged there. So she is considered his wife, even though she's a concubine, he's the husband, and the concubine's father is his father-in-law. So then we're always thinking, okay, well, so then what's the difference? Like, if it's not that concubine's not married, you know, and you know, Solomon had 700 concubines and 300 wives, but if the concubines are just wives, why wouldn't it just say he's got 1,000 wives and not concubines? Well, here's the thought, right? The thought might be here, where in Deuteronomy 22, verse 28, where a man is actually, like a woman is actually legally forced to be that man's wife because they've slept together. And maybe that's what a concubine is. I'm not 100% on this, but this is just a couple of thoughts, right? Is a concubine a wife, but a wife out of legal necessity, but not a wife where they've actually been betrothed and made the vows, and now that's why they're husband and wife? So, you know, is that the difference? I don't know. But I'm just had a thought there. So, and it's interesting that when I said this to Elizabeth, I said, hey, maybe that's the difference between a concubine and a wife. And I'm pretty sure we had this conversation before. I don't know why she's never said this before. But I said, maybe that's the difference between a concubine and a wife. Like, a concubine is, you know, a wife is somebody you're betrothed to, and then you marry, and it's like this legitimate marriage. And then a concubine is somebody that two people fornicated, and then they were forced legally. The law now recognizes them as husband and wife, and if she went and married another, she would be committing adultery, but they didn't have the betrothal. And that's why it's sort of like an illegitimate wife as opposed to a normal wife, which is, has the betrothal and the vows and the covenant between them. But even though there is no covenant between a man and his concubine, it's the law that makes him not be able to put her away. Do you see the difference? So I don't know whether that's the difference. But then I said this to Elizabeth, right? And Elizabeth said, oh, in Mexico, yeah, that's what they call a concubine, where like a man might have like a mistress and it's like he's got like another wife, and everyone sort of knows he's got this other woman, even though he lives with his wife, but he still treats the other woman like his wife. Like, he still provides for her, he still looks after her, cares for her children. He takes on that duty, if you think about it, of a wife, but it wasn't his actual legitimate wife. They would call that the concubine. So it's interesting that's still known, but probably in our culture it's just something that has been lost, in terms of we don't really know what a concubine is, and we think it's just a girlfriend that's fornicating with her boyfriend. That would just be a whore, not a concubine. I don't know if that's interesting for you. So that's what an unmarried virgin is. So we kind of know, and just a bit about fornication and the seriousness in which God treats it. Now, before I get into betrothal, I want to just talk about the vows, in terms of the laws regarding making vows. And this is something that's always been interesting when I bring this up to people. It was interesting when I learned it, I just read it one day in the Bible, and I thought, hey, like, this law seems to be teaching that a father has veto power over his daughter's vows, and the same with a husband has veto power. And when I explain this to people, it's a bit of a shock, right? Because we are always of the mindset, well, we've got this feminist attitude of a woman is her own and she can make the decisions. But that's not what the Bible teaches, and it teaches it for good reason. You know, one is because of accountability to God, and another is for protection against women who are more emotionally driven. But let's read Numbers 30. It says here, and Moses spake unto the heads of the tribes concerning the children of Israel, saying, this is the thing which the Lord hath commanded. If a man vow a vow unto the Lord, or swear an oath to bind his soul with a bond, so vowing or swearing, same thing, he shall not, and it's not, swearing is not like what we would say when you say the F word or S word, like when the Bible talks about like cursing and swearing and vowing. Cursing is when you like want evil to happen to somebody, you pronounce evil on somebody. Swearing is making a vow or a promise or an oath. He shall not break his word, he shall do according to all that proceedeth out of his mouth. And here we go into the women. If a woman also vow a vow unto the Lord and bind herself by a bond, being in her father's house in her youth, and her father hear her vow. So now this is a daughter, a woman who's a daughter. She's in her father's house, so she's not married, right? Because if you're married, now you're in your husband's house. So she's in her father's house in her youth, and her father hear her vow, and her bond wherewith she had bound her soul, and her father shall hold his peace at her, then all her vows shall stand, and every bond wherewith she hath bound her soul shall stand. But if her father disallow her in the day that he heareth, not any of her vows or of her bonds wherewith she hath bound her soul shall stand. And the Lord shall forgive her because her father disallowed her. And if she had at all an husband when she vowed or uttered aught out of her lips wherewith she bound her soul. So now we've got the situation of a husband and his wife, right? So before it was the daughter and the father, this is the husband and the wife. Uttered aught out of her lips wherewith she bound her soul, and her husband heard it and held his peace at her in the day that he heard it. So I just want you to take note there. That same phrase was used in the daughter and father. It's in the day that he heard it. So it's not the day that the vow is made. So it's not like you can go and sneak off, you know, make a vow. You know, your dad didn't know about it. And then it's like, well, it's too late now because I've made the vow. No, because when he hears that vow and he's like, no, you're not making that vow, then your vow does not stand. But if when in the day he hears it, he allows it, and he might not even approve of it. But if he doesn't disallow it, then it stands, right? So it's the day that he hears it, not the day that the vow is made. Then her vows shall stand, and her bonds wherewith she bound her soul shall stand. And I think it's very important, because if a father does use this veto power to a daughter, and the daughter has gone off and made a vow, and he says no, that marriage is not actually legitimate, you know, because now they're in fornication, because there's no covenant there. And I guess I don't know whether that makes her then a concubine as opposed to a normal wife, right? Because legally, if they fornicated, then they would be forced to marry in that government. But if the government doesn't force them to marry, then obviously it would be still fornication. But if her husband disallowed her on the day that he heard it, then he shall make her vow which she vowed, and that which she uttered with her lips wherewith she bound her soul of none effect, and the Lord shall forgive her. So you see her here, if she makes a vow and the father doesn't allow it or the husband doesn't allow it, she can now break that vow and it's forgiven of her because she wasn't allowed to make that vow. I mean, she shouldn't even be making those vows to begin with, but she's now not held accountable to that vow. Now it goes on to widows, right? So what is a widow? A widow is somebody whose husband has died, right? But every vow of a widow or of her that is divorced, so somebody who has legitimately been divorced, so they no longer have a husband, or somebody who has been widowed, their husband has died, wherewith they have bound their souls, shall stand against her. So it seems here that when a woman's authority figure dies, they are no longer under an authority, you know? So that's it's interesting there that they're only under an authority whilst their authority is alive. So a divorced woman, and I think we'll see here later on as I show you that even if like a woman is not married and her father dies, the brother does not become an authority because she is now like a widow in the sense that her authority has died. And she can make decisions for herself. Well, she can make vows for herself, not just decisions, obviously. But if she vowed in her husband's house or bound her soul by a bond with an oath, and her husband heard it and held his peace at her and disallowed her not, then all her vows shall stand, and every bond wherewith she bound her soul shall stand. But if her husband hath utterly made them void on the day he heard them, so again, the day he heard them, then whatsoever proceedeth out of her lips concerning her vows or concerning the bond of her soul shall not stand. Her husband hath made them void, and the Lord shall forgive her. So it's interesting that, you know, a woman in our society, I mean, obviously in a perfect society, if a woman went to marry somebody else, she'd be put to death, right? Because it'd be adultery. But in our society, when they're not put to death, a woman, technically, in the eyes of God, could not make that vow and be betrothed to somebody else, right? Because unless the husband allows it, if he allows it, then he's allowed her to then marry and have two husbands, which is like, you know, obviously not an ideal situation. Every vow and every binding oath to afflict the soul, her husband may establish it or her husband may make it void. But if her husband altogether hold his peace at her from day to day, so again, it can't be like, well, I'm thinking about whether to allow your vow and you just string it out for a couple of days. It has to be the day you hear it. Then he establishes all her vows and all her bonds which are upon her. He confirmeth them because he held his peace at her in the day that he heard them. So you see there, it's not that he needs to approve the vow. He just needs to hold the peace at the vow and not say anything to disallow it, and it will stand. But if he shall in any ways make them void after that he hath heard them, then he shall bear her iniquity. So what it's saying there is if he allows the vow and then makes her break it, now it's actually the dad's fault because he allowed that vow to pass. And we would take that into, say, like engagement, where two people make a promise, right? And a father might be thinking, well, I don't want them to get married, but I've allowed them to promise to get married. Well, that's kind of too late too, because it would be his sin to break that engagement and not make them carry out the promise that they made. So these are the statutes which the Lord commanded Moses between a man and his wife, between the father and his daughter, being yet in her youth in her father's house. So let's have a look at some of the examples from Scripture of this playing out. 1 Corinthians 7, verse 39. I think it's very important because we think that it's just the woman's choice who she marries, right? But again, according to the Bible, it's not only the woman's choice. Yes, the father may allow her to choose. I don't think the father can necessarily choose for her, but he can veto, meaning he can make null a decision that she wants to make in terms of a vow or an oath. So it says here in 1 Corinthians 7, the wife is bound by the law as long as her husband liveth. But if her husband be dead, she is at liberty to be married to whom she will, only in the Lord. So I've often seen this verse used to teach that women can choose to marry whoever they want. But according to Numbers 30, a father could say, no, you're not marrying that. But why is this woman in 1 Corinthians 7 allowed to marry whom she will? Why? Because she's a widow. Like in Numbers 30, she's a widow, her husband's dead, she can marry who she wants, right? Because she doesn't have an authority, she can make the vow, and there's no authority to stop her. Now, let's look at 1 Timothy, chapter 5. Now, if a woman is young and immature, this is not an ideal scenario where she's either been widowed or her father has died, right? And she doesn't have this authority over it. Why? Well, let's read in 1 Timothy 5. But the younger widows refuse, for when they have begun to wax wanton against Christ, they will marry, having damnation because they have cast off their first faith. So what is this? This is like saying, it could be like somebody who's made a vow to God that's saying like, you know, I'm not going to get married. I'm just going to serve God, you know, and make this careless vow because they are young and immature. It's like people that, you know, they go to these youth conferences and they get them to come down the aisle and they make this vow to say, oh God, like I'm giving you my life. I'm going to be this preacher and making this vow to God. And they're just young and immature and they don't know what decision they're making. They don't actually even know what it entails. They're not even married, let alone have children and all these things. And they're making this decision that is one of the biggest responsibilities that you can have, which is to feed the flock of God. But it's like that with young women as well. Like they probably make decisions like that too, where they're going to dedicate themselves to God and then they realize they can't do that. And then they want to marry, and that's what it's saying. They have that damnation because they've broken this vow, you know? Because they've cast off their first faith. And withal they learn to be idle, wandering about from house to house. And not only idle, but tattlers also, and busybodies, speaking things which they ought not. See, the Bible's timeless. Right? Nothing has changed. You know, you read this passage and you're like thinking, I know somebody like that, right? Because this is the sinful nature of man. So this is a dangerous situation for them to be in, because women are driven by their emotions and they can make foolish decisions because they're driven by emotions, whereas men are tend to be, there are emotional men. I'm not saying there aren't emotional men and there aren't like women who aren't necessarily driven by their emotions. But as a nature that we have and how we're created, we see that from Adam and Eve, right? So this is why God put man in authority. That's why he's accountable. And this is a reason why women have an authority over them. So they don't make these careless vows. And men can think more clearly and soberly and know when they're making a silly decision. A silly vow, because a vow obviously lasts until for life. So it says here, I will therefore that the younger women marry, bear children, guide the house, give none occasion to the adversary to speak reproachfully. So for some are already turned aside after Satan. So we see here not only the will for a young woman to not just be a, you know, career-driven woman and, you know, wanting to do what a man does, but the will of God for a young woman is to marry, bear children, and guide the house. And the reason why he's exhorting this to the younger widows to marry, bear children, and guide the house, because the younger widows no longer have that authority over them, remember? So they don't have that authority, and because they don't, it's not an ideal situation for them to be in. And this is why they should marry, put themselves back under an authority, a husband, marry, bear children, and guide the house, so they don't become this tattler, this idle busybody, wandering about from house to house or to Facebook page to Facebook page. That's how women do it now, right? They don't go from house to house. They don't even go from phone to phone. Now they just go from Facebook to Facebook group, you know, being tattlers. You know, that's like the new house to house. You join one group and then it's always interesting watching these Facebook groups implode, right? Because they're like, oh, you know, they don't like this Facebook group, and then they go join another Facebook group and it starts growing, and then there's strife in there, and then they start another one, and then these people are just going from Facebook group to Facebook group. So this is why this woman is allowed to marry who she will in 1 Corinthians 7. 1 Timothy 5, we see why that's probably a good idea, a bad idea for younger women to stay unmarried. And, you know, I guess the assumption is in verse 40 in 1 Corinthians 7 is when he says here, but she is happier if she so abide after my judgment. I think also that I have the Spirit of God. Obviously, that's going to align with what he's teaching in 1 Timothy 5. So the assumption probably there is when an older lady, you know, she can, if she wants, marry somebody else, but somebody maybe who's over 60 may be happier if she just so abides, right? That's Paul's judgment. Let's go to another example, Numbers 36, the daughters of Zelophehad. So if you don't know that story, I'll just go to the end. Basically, I just won't read it all for sake of time, but basically Zelophehad was one of the children of Israel who was given a portion of inheritance, but he died, right, and he didn't have any sons. So because he didn't have any sons, the inheritance was not apportioned, it was apportioned to his daughters. So he had, I think, four or five daughters, the daughters of Zelophehad, you know, Noah, Milcah, Mahlah, Tirzah, and something else. So the daughters of Zelophehad were kind of like, well, that's not very fair. Like, just because our father died, does that mean there's no inheritance to his name just because he didn't have any sons? So Moses says, okay, you know, that's true. They seek the Lord's will, and basically God tells them, you know, they've spoken well, so then the inheritance can be apportioned to his daughters rather than his sons to carry on the name of their father. But then they say, well, wait a second, but when a woman marries a man, she then joins his house. So that's not fair either, because then how, because they're saying, well, how does then his inheritance get passed on? Because when they marry somebody else, the inheritance is going to get passed on to that other family. And then at the year of Jubilee, every 50 years, the inheritance goes back to the rightful owner, which will now be a different family and not Zelophehad. So they say, oh, yeah, okay, well, yeah, that makes sense. So they say, well, then therefore, the daughters of Zelophehad, they say here, let them marry to whom they think best. So what I'm getting from that is, see, they originally would have the choice of who they could marry, right? Because their father is dead. They can marry whoever they want because they no longer have that authority. But because of the inheritance and how God wanted to manage the inheritance that it would always be in that family, they put another condition on the daughters of Zelophehad. And in fact, any daughter where the situation was when somebody died and he didn't have any sons, he says here, let them marry to whom they think best, only to the family of the tribe of their father shall they marry. So shall not the inheritance of the children of Israel remove from tribe to tribe, for every one of the children of Israel shall keep himself to the inheritance of the tribe of his fathers. So that's the story of the daughters of Zelophehad. That's why they could only marry within their family because of inheritance. But the point I'm trying to bring there is we see an example of that authority no longer being there. So they had the choice, you know, to whom they think best. But again, that the daughters of Zelophehad, again, is another passage that is gone to show that women have ultimate authority over their choice of who to vow to, but they don't, because Numbers 30 obviously needs to align with these. And it does, because you see here, dad dead, and you see in 1 Corinthians 7, husband dead. Now this one, let's go here to Genesis 24. This one is not as a strong example, but I just wonder as well, when it comes to the story of Rebecca, if you're not familiar with the story of Rebecca, that's Isaac's wife, so that was Abraham's son. And Abraham's son, you know, maybe not very social or whatnot, not getting much luck, couldn't find a wife. So Abraham sends his servant to go and find a wife. And he says, hey, choose somebody of my family. And that's when the servant goes and he's praying to God, like, God, you know, bring this lady along and, you know, lead me in the way. And he's saying, he's down by the well. And then he says basically, oh, you know, the women, you know, when they come, the women that not only draws water, but draws water from my camels as well, that's going to be the daughter that I think that, that God has led me to. So then Rebecca comes and then draws water. And then when he asks for water, she draws water for him, but says, hey, can I draw water for your camels and your cattle as well, or the camels? So he's like, wow, like and he's even in doubt, the servant, because he's like, is this the woman that God has led me to? And then he finds out that Rebecca is of his house too, because Abraham didn't want him to choose a wife of the families of Canaan and everything. He wanted, you know, a believer in a sense. So she was of the house of Laban, which was part of the family, and that's where Rebecca came from. But where we read here, when he actually goes to talk to Laban, which is Rebecca's brother, this is in verse 54 to 67. So he's there. The servant is telling Laban, right? You know, this is this woman. This is how God has led me. You know, don't make me tarry, because he's making the servant stay there and enjoy hospitality and things like that. And he says here, he said unto them, hinder me not, seeing the Lord hath prospered my way. Send me away that I may go to my master. And they said, we will call the damsel and inquire at her mouth. And they called Rebekah and said unto her, wilt thou go with this man? And she said, I will go. And they sent away Rebekah, their sister and her nurse, and Abraham's servant and his men. So it's interesting that when he went to go see Rebekah's family, he didn't go to Rebekah's dad. So I wonder if it's because Rebekah's dad was dead at that point. And, you know, I guess Laban was just talking with the servant, but ultimately they gave Rebekah the choice because she didn't have maybe an authority either over her. So that might be another example, but it just makes me think, I wonder if that's why they gave her that choice and asked her what she wanted to do there. Now, what are the implications of this law of a husband or a father being able to veto the vows of a daughter or a wife? And it means that marriage ceremonies can be very simple, because sometimes people ask, well, what makes a marriage? What are the essential parts of a marriage that make it legitimate? Now, people have this question about baptisms as well, right? And for those of you who went to the last baptism, I sort of talked about what makes a baptism valid or legitimate, as I believe according to the Bible. People have that same question about marriage. They're kind of like, well, if I'm not married in a church building, am I really married? Like, did I get married properly? Or like if somebody, like, you know, like if I have a minister marry, if I have a judge of the justice of the peace marry me, am I married? Or should I be married by a minister of religion? What if the minister of religion is not saved? Am I married? You know, like, people have like these sort of questions. So they're like, they kind of like, because obviously if you want to please God, you want to do the right thing, you want to make sure that all the things are there, because you want to make sure I'm actually married and I'm doing the right thing. So there's all these questions around that. But the way I see the teaching of the Bible is, when you get married to somebody, it's a covenant between two people, right? Now, obviously, the man can make his own covenant, but the woman, the father has to allow the covenant. So it's between two people. The way we get this minister officiating, I honestly believe it's like a tradition of the Catholic Church, just the fact that somebody has to pronounce things. You know, it's like the doctor has to pronounce somebody dead. It's not good enough that they are dead, right? Somebody has to come and go, yep, they're dead. And it's like, now only they're really dead. You know, it wasn't that. It's like birth. It's like, why do you need a birth certificate? It's this idea that like some government official, you know, has to pronounce this, like, you are alive officially, you are dead officially, and it's like you are married officially, you are baptized officially. It's traditions of men. So in the Bible, it's a covenant between two people. So when you make a covenant between two people, that's all the two people that have to be involved. But because a woman can't make a vow without her father, obviously the father has to be involved in the sense that he has to allow that vow. And once that vow has happened, they're betrothed. They are, and then there's the marriage, which is when they actually come together and consummate. So those are the key parts. So the implication is a marriage ceremony could be very simple. And it's funny when I tell this to people, I've had people even in this church say to me, oh, does that just mean like if I was over in that corner and her dad was here, like we could just get married and we would be husband and wife? And it's like, well, yeah. I mean, it's not common. It's just that people make a wedding, and there's nothing wrong with it. You know, people want to make it a big occasion. You know, they want to celebrate. They want to have this official ceremony so that it's important. It's honored, and that there are many other reasons why somebody might want to put on a party for a wedding ceremony. Even though the fundamentals of it is, yeah, I mean, if you agree with the father in the privacy of your own home, and he's like, yeah, that's it. And we have examples of that. I mean, even with the example here in Genesis 24, and these are the examples I give people, where if you remember, Rebecca said she wanted to go, so she came back, right? She's veiled her face. She gets off her camel when she sees Isaac. And it says here, and the servant told Isaac all things that he had done, and Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent and took Rebekah, and she became his wife, and he loved her, and Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. Now, what sort of ceremony was that? Right? Where, you know, she's coming back from the country afar, she gets off the camel, they have they're betrothed, he takes her into his tent, they're married. You know, so it wasn't like it was a big hoo-ha, but we do have examples of big hoo-has. So I'm not saying it's wrong. And even Jesus graced a marriage with his presence in John 2. And think about the marriage supper of the Lamb. Now, that's going to be the biggest celebration there is. So there's definitely nothing wrong with celebrations, right? I mean, God will throw the ultimate celebration, the marriage supper of the Lamb. But the reason why I think those are the only elements that need to be there, because we see the first marriage in Genesis 2. You know, therefore shall a man... So we see here, and the rib which the Lord God hath taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. So what I see in this passage is God, who is Eve's father, brings the woman to Adam. And it's almost like, you know, when the father walks the bride down the aisle, that's what that's sort of representing, is that the father is presenting his daughter to the man. And he's there as witness when they take each other, the vows, because Adam says, hey, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. So that's what I would say represents that vow, that they are taking each other as husband and wife in the presence of Eve's father, who's there as God. And then we get that passage on a man leaving his father and mother and cleaving unto his wife. And then in verse 25, it's no longer the woman, it's the man and his wife. Right? And they were not ashamed. So those are the elements. And that's why a marriage can be very simple. And not everybody has a big wedding. You know, some people just get married at the court office. You know, because maybe there are some people that just have been together for a long time and they don't have a lot of outside friends and they don't want to make it a big deal. There's nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with small celebrations, no celebration, nothing wrong with big celebrations. There's nothing holy about the building. Do you know what I mean? So some people, like, they really want to get married in a building, but there's nothing holy about this building. We are the holy temple. We are the spiritual temple. We are what make this building holy. No, the building doesn't make us holy, right? It's the holy house of God that makes the building holy. So I know a lot of people like feel they need to get married in a church building. It's more just a tradition. I personally think, practically wise, it's probably easier getting married just at one location, because then you don't have to move everybody. But people have this frame of mind. But I'm just saying, it's just a tradition. There's nothing wrong or right. It's just a preference. So if your marriage was made void, I guess that would make you a concubine, as opposed to a legitimate wife, if the vow is disallowed. Because if they go ahead and sleep together anyway, then you'd have to pay the 50 shekels of silver. They'd be your wife, but it would be a concubine. And I already talked about a wife in our day and age marrying somebody else if the husband allows it, because technically the husband could not allow that vow to pass, but that would be adultery anyway. Now let's spend the last 15 minutes just talking about betrothal. So what is betrothal? A lot of people have the idea that betrothal is the same as engagement, like they're just interchangeable, they're just one and the same thing. And they're not. So the way we think of engagement now, when we say a couple is engaged to marry, is very different to what betrothal is in the Bible and what it represents, or what it is, sorry. So what is betrothal? Let's go to Exodus 21, verse 8. Is that where I wanted to go? Exodus 20. Let's go to Deuteronomy first. 28. Okay, so I'm just trying to show you some verses. Like, I believe I have the right definition of these terms based on the verses that I'm going to show you. But I believe betrothal is the vow that transfers ownership of the woman. Right? So as bad as that sounds, in our day, in our feminist culture, women are property of men. And children are property of parents. And why is that? Because men are accountable to God for those people. Just like if you're at a business, you have may have a portfolio that you are accountable for, you have, in a sense, ownership or stewardship of that person. So it's the same with a man, because he's the head of the home. He is accountable to God, right? Just like I am accountable to God for this church. So, and that, it would make a sense. And you know, it sounds bad in our day and age, because when we think of somebody owning somebody, we think of slavery. And we think of oppression, and we think of, like, you know, not treating somebody well. But that's not necessarily the case, because think about it, we belong to God, don't we? Don't we? Aren't we owned by Jesus? I'll be gladly owned by Jesus. Why? Because of how Jesus treats me, how he takes care of me. He has my best interests at heart. So it's not about, there's not a problem with belonging to somebody, it's how you are treated. And there are laws around how you treat people. You know, a master cannot just treat his servant however he likes. But does the servant belong to him? Yes, right? So so that's what betrothal is. And that's why it's not the same as engagement. Because when you're engaged to somebody in our culture, what we would refer to as engagement, you do not yet own that woman. She's still your, you know, your fiancé, but we would say that they still are part of that family. Right, so you see how it's not the same, but betrothal is when she now is actually your wife. She actually belongs to you, and if the father does not allow you to take your wife later on and live with her, he's actually robbing you of something that belongs to you, right? So I believe betrothal, the right definition would be that it's the vow that transfers ownership. And I'll just show you this verse here in Deuteronomy 28. Thou shalt betroth the wife, and another man shall lie with her. Now, how do I get it from that? Well, because when you read on to other things, thou shalt build a house, and thou shalt not dwell therein, thou shalt plant a vineyard, and shalt not gather the grapes thereof. So these are some of the curses that God would put on the nation of Israel if they went away from him, which they did. But I want you to see here, the theme here is that something, it's something you own, but you don't get to enjoy. Right? You build the house, but you don't get to live in it. But the house is yours. The house was yours, but you didn't get to enjoy it. The vineyard was yours, but you didn't get to enjoy it. You betrothed the wife, so the wife was yours, but you didn't get to enjoy the wife. You didn't get to lie with the wife. So it just fits that definition of what that's what betrothal is, when it actually transfers ownership. And I want to show you here, this is why I went to Exodus 21, that the dowry in the Bible, which is the cost of marrying a daughter. Now, the father of the daughter doesn't have to accept a dowry; he can be giving a gift to a man. But if he wanted to, he could charge, right? He could have that dowry, and a lot of cultures still do this, where you actually pay a dowry to the father to marry his daughter, and that fits in with the theme of that ownership of property, because there's a value to the father of that daughter. And this is where I think, and it's interesting. This is where I think Exodus 21:8 fits into the picture. Because a lot of people go to this passage and try and teach that, oh, you know, a man can just sell his daughter into slavery, which is not what I think this passage is talking about. I think this is actually referring to when somebody is betrothed to somebody else and the dowry is paid. In a sense, that's like you've sold your daughter to this man, which is actually what's happening. So it says here in Exodus 21, if she pleased not her master who had betrothed her to himself, right? Oh, wait, where am I going? From verse 7. And if a man sell his daughter to be a maidservant, she shall not go out as the men servants do. So we see here a man selling his daughter, right? But what is it? Is he just selling her into slavery, like the picture most people would get when they read this? No. It says here, if she please not her master, who hath betrothed her to himself. Then shall he let her be redeemed to sell her unto a strange nation. He shall have no power, seeing he hath not dealt deceitfully with her. He hath dealt deceitfully with her. So I believe this is what this passage is referring to when somebody has betrothed them. See how he now belongs to her. So in a sense that he's bought her and he's betrothed her as his wife. But he's saying here that if he doesn't fulfill that, like he's deceived her because he's betrothed her and now she, you know, she's his property, but then he didn't actually go and fulfill the obligations. He's just saying like he can't sell her to a strange nation. You know, she can now be redeemed. So there's some laws around that. But I think that's where it sort of fits into the bigger picture of betrothal, where it's the vow that transfers ownership, and that's when the dowry would be paid, because that's when the ownership is changing place. Now let's go to Deuteronomy 22, verse 22. Now another thing that is different is because betrothal transfers ownership, and when you are betrothed, you are now considered that person's wife. If a person who is betrothed goes and marries somebody else or commits fornication, that is adultery. That is the death. That is the death penalty as well, according to the Bible. So, the sin of adultery is sleeping with somebody's wife, right? Whether they're married, betrothed, or whatnot, right? Because that's the sin of adultery that we read in Leviticus 20. And we see here in Deuteronomy 22, if a man be found lying with a woman married to an husband, then they shall both of them die, both the man that lay with the woman and the woman, so shalt thou put away evil from Israel. But see, if a damsel that is a virgin, so you see here that she's a virgin, she has not slept with anyone, but she's betrothed, be betrothed unto an husband, and a man find her in the city and lie with her, then ye shall bring them both out unto the gate of that city, and ye shall stone them with stones that they die. The damsel, because she cried not, being in the city, and the man, because he hath humbled his neighbor's wife. So thou shalt put away evil from among you. So that's another difference between betrothal and engagement, is that, you know, because they're not the wife, it's not the same penalty, according to the Bible, as sleeping with somebody that is betrothed. So you see here that the betrothal is a lot more of a serious vow than engagement, even though engagement is usually the vow that couples will take before betrothal, right? Which is the marriage vows you do at your ceremony. But that vow that you're making when you say, I promise to marry you, it's not taking into account ownership and the dowry, and if you then break that and marry somebody else, you're committing adultery, as opposed to just breaking a vow that you've made, which is also a sin. So the modern day concept of engagement is when you've made a vow but there's no transfer of ownership. Now the laws of vows still apply, in the sense that if two people have promised to marry each other, if they break that vow, that's still a sin. Did you know that? So a lot of people break these engagements because they think, well, I'm engaged, I'll just break it, there's no big deal. No, it's still a sin to break the vow. It's just that if you're not betrothed, if you go marry somebody else, you're not committing adultery. You've just broken a promise with somebody. But then, and you know, the implication of that is if you promise to marry somebody that is the wrong choice, you still need to go ahead with that. Do you know what I mean? Because a lot of people, they promise to marry somebody and they've made this vow foolishly, and people are like, well, you know, they had to break the engagement because the marriage would have been a disaster. It would have been terrible. But actually, the right thing to do, as hard as it is, according to the Bible, and I understand, I mean, it's like with people getting remarried, right? It's like you understand why they do it. But that doesn't mean it's right just because it's not easy to do. So in the Bible teaches that if you make a vow, you go through with it, even if it's to your own hurt. So let me show you that here. I'll show you in Psalms 15:4. This is talking about just right things. If you look at the beginning, it talks about who shall abide in thy tabernacle, who shall dwell in thy holy hill, and it talks about how to walk righteously. So obviously, we know in the New Testament, we don't get saved by work salvation. We're saved by believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, but we can get direction from what is right. And one of the things that is mentioned here, it says here in verse 4, in whose eyes a vile person is contemned, but he honoreth them that fear the Lord. He that sweareth to his own hurt and changeth not. So you see here that, you know, if you make a vow, you have to go through with it, even if now it damages you. Isn't that a sobering thought when you promise things to people? You know, God is saying here that even if it is not good for you and is now a terrible thing to do, you have to go through with it because you've promised to do it, and you have to vow and you have to pay. Now, whenever I think of foolish vows, and this is why fathers can veto vows, because it's generally women, because they're emotionally driven, they will make those vows in the heat of the moment. That's why people make those silly decisions about the ministry at these youth camps, where they're emotionally driven, they're away from society, they're not thinking soberly, they've just listened to this powerful sermon, and now they're going to make this decision, you know, this decision to serve God and make this vow. It's the same with women, right? Like, it's, you know, women generally, more often than not, as a generalization, they get carried away with this man that has swept them off their feet and make these vows, and that's what God is trying to protect them from. So, because if you promise to marry this guy and he's bad news, because he's the head of the home, you're going to be in a world of hurt. Whereas the other way around, it's usually not so bad, because the man is the head of the home, and if he's spiritual, he can generally lead that woman because he has more say in that household. But a woman doesn't, because she has to submit to her husband. And if you promise to marry somebody and he's going to be a terrible husband, you're not swearing to your own hurt, because you, for the rest of your life, you're going to be married to this person. You're going to have a terrible life. If hopefully, you know, by the grace of God, you can swing that around, but you still have to go through with it. And you know what? Every time I think of a foolish vow, do you know who I think of? I don't know if you guys know this story of Jephthah. Yeah, probably you guys down the front do, but Jephthah is this guy in Judges that made a foolish vow, but because, even though he made this foolish vow, he went through with it because he vowed to his own hurt, and he ended up actually hurting somebody else. It says here, then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jephthah, and he passed over Gilead and Manasseh, and passed over Mizpeh of Gilead. And I won't read the rest there. Jephthah vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, if thou shalt without fail deliver the children of Ammon into mine hands, then it shall be, and you just think, why would you even say something like this? Then it shall be that whatsoever cometh forth of my doors of my house to meet me when I return in peace from the children of Ammon shall surely be the Lord's, and I will offer it up for a burnt offering. So you realize what he's saying. He's vowing to the Lord here, saying, if God basically helps me win this battle, when I go back to my home, whatever comes, the first thing that comes to the door to greet me, I'm going to offer that up for a burnt offering. And you just got to think, like, why would you even say, you know, maybe Jephthah had this dog that maybe it was his wife's dog that he really hated, like this poodle or something. And maybe the poodle always came to the door, and he's like making this vow thinking like, oh, you know, maybe the poodle's going to come to me and I can offer it up for a burnt offering. But look what happens. So the Jephthah passed over unto the children of Ammon to fight against them, and the Lord delivered them into his hand. So the Lord fulfilled what he wanted him to do. And he smote them. And look at this. This is verse 34. And Jephthah came to Mizpeh unto his house, and behold, his daughter came out to meet him with timbrels and with dancers, and she was his only child. Beside her he had neither son nor daughter. And it came to pass when he saw her that he rent his clothes and said, alas, my daughter, thou hast brought me very low. She did? You're the one that made the foolish vow. And thou art one of them that trouble me, for I've opened my mouth unto the Lord, and I cannot go back. And then she goes into the wilderness to bewail her virginity. So he goes through with it. So we need to, as Christians, realize the power of our tongue when we make promises to people, you know, when we make vows. And it's the same, you know, when you say you're going to be somewhere, you got to be there. You got to have integrity. You got to have, you know, you either say yay or yay, nay, nay. But if you're going to vow something, which is that you promise before the Lord and you swear an oath, you need to go through with it. It's a very serious thing in God's eyes, because salvation is an oath of God. And that's why he treats oaths so seriously. That's why he treats marriage so seriously, because marriage is a picture of Christ and the church. Same with vows. Like, he has vowed a vow that you will be saved when you believe on Jesus Christ, and he will not break that vow, even though it's to his own hurt, because he will save somebody that is not worthy of salvation. He will save people that end up becoming his enemies if they've believed on him. So he vows to his own hurt. He will never leave thee nor forsake thee. He will not break his vow, right? Even though we do not perform as we ought to as Christians. So you might say, yeah, well, the, you know, that marriage would have been a disaster if they never, if they go ahead. Well, careless vows should not be made in the first place. And we talked about why that is with women having authority over them. Now, the last one is espousal. Now, I won't cover this one in depth because I'll end it here, but basically, espousal, I believe, is the exact same as betrothal in the sense that you have made the vow, you belong to them, and we think of Mary and Joseph, his espoused wife is referred to. So you see how she's espoused. She's the wife, but they are not yet living together, right? Because he hasn't taken her yet, and we'll see that in more depth next week. But espousal is, I believe, exactly the same as a betrothal, meaning you've made the vow, you're the wife, and that's why if you're somebody's spouse, you're their wife. And we refer to our wife as our spouse or our husband as our spouse because you have been espoused. I guess it's just the way we talk, right? We wouldn't say they're our betrothed or whatever. But that's what espousal is. And we'll just show you this verse. This is Hosea 4 verse 13, and we'll look at the other verses next week. It says here, they sacrifice upon the tops of the mountains and burn incense upon the hills under the oaks and poplars and elms because the shadow thereof is good. Therefore your daughters shall commit whoredom and your spouses shall commit adultery. So we see here that the spouse commits adultery because the spouse is a wife. That's where you get the word espoused from. But we'll look at that a bit more in depth next week. Anyways, I hope that was interesting for you. I guess I did want to focus in this sermon about the vows and about the law of vows and how that works. So I hope that gave you some information on how that works. All right, let's pray. All right, thank you, Lord. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the instruction you give us, and thank you for the guidance that it gives us. We know how to apply these things to our everyday lives. And as we learn your laws, Lord, we learn about how you want a country to be governed and what makes a righteous, godly nation, laws. It helps us to judge laws that are in our country and helps us, Lord, to know the right thing to do in any given situation in a topic that is so important to many of us, and that is the topic of marriage. So, Lord, continue to teach us. I pray, Lord, that this was interesting and edified the people here, that they learned something tonight about the different laws in the Old Testament. Pray, Lord, that they'll continue to grow, and pray that you'll use our church. Thank you for the 2 years, and pray, Lord, that we'll do greater things, and Lord, people will be growing and getting involved, and Lord, we'll be a force to be reckoned with in this country. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.